Rabbit Run is the story of Harry Angstrom Rabbit, a former high school basketball star living in an average American town who finds himself in a dead-end life. So he runs away from his commitments of his pregnant wife and his son with a new woman. But once his wife gives birth, he must return home to be a father. But once again, like Rabbit always does, after a fight, he runs again. Once stressed, his wife accidentally kills their newborn son, and at his funeral, Rabbit accuses her of killing him, loudly shown here. This leaves Rabbit confused which way to turn, towards his old life or new.
We have gathered here today to say our goodbyes to Rebecca June Angstrom.
Don't look at me. I didn't kill the baby.
Memories of the Ford Administration is about an average professor, Alfred Clayton, who is responding to a question asking him what he remembers about the administration of Gerald Ford and is submitting it to the Northern New England Association of American Historians, which he works for. He writes a response mixing his biography of James Buchanan that he is writing and his own life. He discusses James Buchanan's sexual relationships and his dealings as president leading up to the Civil War. Regarding the actual Ford administration, he focuses more on his life and detailing his sex life, including his affair with Genevieve, who are both committing adultery and who struggle if they should leave their spouse for each other, shown here.
I told him.
You told him? You told him what?
About us.
He did?
Was that wrong? He's been sensing something lately, and we got to talking last night, and he was so innocent, it seemed cruel not to tell him. Wasn't that right?
And what did he say?
Well, we said many things. We were up until 3 hashing over our whole marriage, but basically he said, fine, if that's what I want, and if you'll marry me. Did I do the wrong thing? I thought we'd agreed.
No, that was right. It sounds as if you're being very honest and brave. Where's Brent now?
He's at church. The communion line was huge, and I said I'll walk home to get the lamb roast in. They'll probably swing by the drugstore for the paper. I was going to call you tomorrow at your office. He said he wouldn't move out until school was over. We won't tell the girls until then, so as not to ruin their grades. So you have until June to tell Norma.
I didn't know Brent went to church.
Only once a year, as a favor to me and the girls.
He loves you.
He says so. Do you want to back out? You may, Al. You mustn't do what feels wrong to you.
You and I feel right. It's just that
it's too much. It is a lot. I think I'll go ahead with my side in any case. He and I have gone too far.
You and he are going to keep living together till June?
That was his proposal.
You and him are going to keep fucking?
Are you and Norma?
I haven't told her yet. The situations aren't parallel. We don't fuck that much anyway. We think about it and drift away. You and that prick really do it. You really just up and told him about us. I can't believe it. Sorry. Everything's fine. I love you. I'm glad you told. Someone had to get the ball rolling. Be brave, darling. I'd love to be your husband.
The Witches of Eastwick is the story of 3 witches who live in average American Eastwick, Jane, Alexandra, and Suki. They each have various married lovers, but then they become friends with Daryl, a single man who they are attracted to but who doesn't commit to any of them, and he throws off the harmony within the group that existed before his arrival. After one of Suki's love interests, Chris, who is not only weak and unfaithful because he has a crush outside of his marriage, but he cannot even tell Suki he has this crush on her, murders his wife, Felicia, and commits suicide, leaving his children behind, shown here. The witches form a friend group, including themselves, Daryl, and the orphan children, Jenny and Chris. The resulting action changes their lives forever.
There are such stupid people running this town. They actually voted to change the name of Landing Square to Kazmarek Square in honor of that idiotic boy who went and got himself killed in Vietnam.
Well, that area really has been a boat landing for the last years. It's all slid in the blizzard of 88.
But it was so pleasant. Up there at the end of Dock Street with the benches for the old people and the old granite obelisk, that it didn't look like a war memorial at all. It
might still be pleasant.
No, it won't. Next thing, they'll want to be naming Dock Street and then that Oak Street and then Eastwick itself after some lower class dropout who couldn't think of anything better to do than go over and napalm villages.
Kazmarek was a pretty good kid, actually. Remember a few years back he was their quarterback and on the honor roll at the same time? That's why people took it so hard when he got killed last summer?
Well, I didn't take it that hard. It's not as if he was even born and bred in Eastwick. His family moved here about 5 years ago and his father refuses to get a job, just works on the highway crew long enough to get another 6 months of unemployment. He was at the meeting tonight wearing a black tie with egg stains all over. Poor Mrs. K, she tried to dress up as not to look like a tart, but I'm afraid she failed.
I don't think Hasmark Square has such a bad ring to it.
No, you wouldn't. You wouldn't think Shithouse Square had a bad ring to it, either. You don't give a damn about the world we pass on to our children, the wars we inflict on the innocent, or whether or not we poison ourselves to death. You're poisoning yourself right now. What do you care? Drag the whole globe down with you the way you look at it.
Our children? I don't see them around to receive the world in whatever shape we pass it on.
Yes, that's another thing you can't stand. The way Jenny and Chris have gone off. As if you can keep children home forever, as if the world doesn't have to change and grow. Wake up, Clyde. You thought life was going to be just like those children's books Mommy and Daddy kept piling on your bed every time you were sick. All these wee astronomers and children's classics and coloring books with safe little outlines and nice pointy crayons in their snug little boxes. In fact, it is an organism, Clyde. The world is an organism. It's vital. It's sensitive. It's moving on, Clyde. While you sit over there playing with that silly little paper of yours as if you were still Mommy's pet sick in bed. Your so-called reporter, Suki Rogemont, was out there tonight at the meeting, her piggy little nose in the air giving me that I know something you don't know look. Don't you think I don't know about you and that minx? I can read you like a book, and don't you forget it, how you'd like to fuck her if you had the guts, but you don't. You don't. You sit here mooning about Jenny and Chris, who've at least had the guts and the sense to kiss this godforsaken town goodbye forever and try to make careers for themselves where things are happening. And you sit here mooning, but do you know what they used to say to me about you? You really want to know, Clyde? They would say, hey Mom, wouldn't it be great if Dad would leave us? But you know, they would have to add, he just doesn't have the guts. He just doesn't have the guts. No guts at all. But he wants to turn the whole town, the entire town, into a memorial for this horrible war. It must all fit. It must be, what do they call it? A syndrome. A drunken weakling wants the entire world to go down with him. Hitler, that's who you remind me of, Clyde. Another weak man the world didn't stand up to. Well, it's not going to happen this time. We're standing up to evil.
Hey, come on, Lishi. Let's call it a day.
All you do is sit there and drink, and you can't even do anything with your life. You just sit there, drunk, upset, can't even go after Suki, who you're obsessed with, which I would know, because I...
Hello, class. My name is Professor Keen, and I will be your psychology teacher for this semester.
Save the Earth! Go green! Don't eat meat! Go long!
I got it!
Professor Keen, I'd like to talk to you about the lecture you gave today.
Professor Keen, I'd like to talk to you about my exam.
Professor Keen, I'd like to talk to you about my paper grade.
to talk.
I can't.
John, we need to talk now. It's important.
I'm busy.
John, we need to talk now.
I can't. I'm busy.
I'm pregnant.
John Updike, good man, good writer, run, rabbit, run, oh yeah, John Updike, pigeon feathers and the witches of Eastwick. Yeah, John Updike, what a great guy, good writer, writing good books and stuff. John Updike, rabbit is rich, rabbit at rest, yeah. John Updike, good, good man, writing good books that people like to read, yeah. How about those pigeon feathers, how about them, oh yeah.